Okay.
I was very diligently trying to find u using the square root of lambda from c times the dyadic product of the eigenvectors, and it wasn't working out for me. And I don't know if it's because the outer product that we talked about in your book is different than the outer product out in the crazy world of computers and or, but it just wasn't working.
It should work out okay. So what you did, I think his question is, how do you find the square root of u? Sorry, how do you find u from c, or how do you find c from u? So what's your question? How do you find c from u, or u from c?
U from the eigenvalues and eigenvectors of c.
Okay, so if you are given c, find its, say, eigenvector and eigenvalue. Then you can write c as lambda 1, n1, tensor product n1, plus lambda 2, no, I'm supposed to be talking, not you. So if you have a question, you should ask me. Okay, that was the one of the rules of the game, right? So otherwise, if all of us talk, then nobody can listen, right? Okay, so it's tensor product N2 plus lambda 3, N3, tensor product N3. So no matter what software you take, it should give, for a given C, it should give you the eigenvalues and the eigenvectors. Then U is square root of lambda 1, N1, tensor product N2. Sorry, not N1. N1 plus square root of lambda 2, tensor product N2, N2 tensor product N2, plus square root of lambda 3, N3 tensor product N3. And that should, it should work.
Yeah.
Could you do a quick example of a tensor product with a symbolic vector like A1, A2, A3, and then B1, B2, B3, because it...
Okay, so let's assume that lambda 1 is a 4, lambda 2 is 9, and lambda 3 is, say, 25. Then N1, let's say, is 1 E1 plus twice E2 plus, say, 3 E3, but then I have to make it a unit vector. So that's 9 plus 4, 13 plus 1, 14. So let's do one more. Then we will say N2 is 3E1 plus 4E2 over 5. So that's a unit vector. And N3 is, say, E1. That's because we are cooking up things, so we may as well cook up a simple one. Yes, speak up. Is it okay?
Yeah.
Okay, so u, square root of lambda 1 is 2. Remember, you have to take positive values. Stretches are positive. So it's twice n1 will be e1 over square root 14 plus twice e2 over square root 14 plus 3 over square root 14 E3 tensor product with N1, so that's again E1 over 14 plus twice E2 over 14 plus 3 over 14 E3 and plus the other two terms. Okay, so which I'm not writing now. Otherwise it will be longer exercise than I thought it will be. So U is an 2, square root of 14 is everywhere, so that basically brings out 14 outside. Because square root of 14 is in these terms, square root of 14 is in these terms. So what we are left with is then E1, tensor product E1, plus twice E1, tensor product E2, plus three times E1, tensor product E3. Then do the same thing with E2. So we have E2 twice of E2 tensor product E1 plus 4 times E2 tensor product E2 plus 6 times E2 tensor product E3 plus 3 times E3 tensor product E1 plus 6 E3 E2 plus 9 E3 E3, and we will have more entries. So I know if you want to write in the matrix form, I guess that's the next question then, right? So if you want to write this in the matrix form, you can, there are two ways to do it. One is either you can look at these, or you can say uij, we should use ulm, because U is in the reference configuration. So this equals EL dotted with U operating upon EM. U operating upon EM will give us a vector. Then you dot it with the EL to get the component. So does it make sense then that U11 is E1, U, E2?
Yeah, that doesn't help me.
Okay, so, will you please press that?
What I'd like to know is if I have two vectors, A, B, C, 1, 2, 3, mm-hmm. what, you know, A dyadic B is in a matrix form. I just want to drive me nuts. Because the definition of the book is A dot B times some crazy other vector C that you have no idea, and I just don't know what it is.
This one you can write.
Yeah. Okay, so the symbol appears in two sides. I still don't know what it does.
Okay, wait. So this is, if you write in terms of matrix, that's A1, B1, A1, B2, mm-hmm. A1, B3.
That's what I thought. So, but that's what I thought the computer was trying to do, and it's apparently not doing.
That I cannot answer because I don't. That's a different story.
But that's the other. Okay, that's what I thought.
Does that help?
Yeah, that's what I wanted to see, but for some reason I wasn't getting. When I did that, mm-hmm. I got something different than.
I think the other people can't hear you unless you press that.
When I did that, I got something different than the matrix square root of U. Like when, so I took U dot U and it did not come back out to C.
It's a good check. I mean, if you find U, then you should multiply, either pre-multiply or post-multiply U with itself, and you should get C. And if you don't get it, that means there is something wrong. Any other question? Yes?
In homework, there was a question about the principal axis of W, which mm-hmm. is for the spin matrix, mm-hmm. and we find imaginary eigenvalues. One eigenvalue is going to be zero, mm-hmm. which related to that eigenvalue is the velocity, is the vorticity vector, I guess, as is defined in the book. Mm-hmm. But we also get two imaginary eigenvectors. So
eigenvectors or eigenvalues?
Eigenvalues and the corresponding eigenvectors are going to be imaginary. So
okay.
what is the interpretation of those if you want to interpret them and as the
that really means
axis?
there is only one real axis of spin. Mm-hmm. And that's it. So it's okay, there's only one real axis of spin.
So if we have imaginary ones, they have no meaning
right.
in the real life.
No. Imaginary, there is no imaginary axis of spin. It has no meaning, right? As far as I know, so it has no meaning. Anything else on your mind? Okay. So what we were doing was we were studying conservation or balance laws. And as I said before, some people call it conservation laws, some people call it balance laws. Some might say equations of motion, or some might say governing equations. So the first one is balance of mass, and that's delta rho over delta t plus delta over delta xi of rho vi equal to zero. And this is true in the present shape omega. So all of these we are going to write in the present configuration. Linear momentum and those of you who are doing PhD, this question will be in the preliminary exam, assuming you have either Mark Kramer or myself on the committee. I cannot otherwise say for anybody else.
Okay.
Chances are that if you have Surat Thangitham, Mark Kramer or I on the committee, this question most likely will be on your preliminary exam, which is a oral exam. So we will ask you, given a continuum, how will you proceed to analyze its deformations? And what is meant is you first give us these three equations, which I'm writing now, balance of mass, linear momentum, and then moment of momentum, which will come. So this is rho AI is delta VI over delta T plus delta VI over delta XJ VJ. So this term is AI, that's the acceleration, equals delta TIJ over delta XJ plus rho VI. I think Mark Kramer likes to use transpose of what I'm doing, but it's the same thing. Yes.
Is that a rho or a p up in the
rho? Rho, rho, rho. Mass density is rho. And third one is moment of momentum. And that is Tij equals Tji. Now the Cauchy stress tensor is symmetric. So in addition to these, we need initial condition, and actually there is one more balance of energy, which I will talk about maybe in a couple of days. Okay. If you are doing a thermomechanical problem, if there is a heat temperature involved, then we also need balance of energy or the first law of thermodynamics. That will come maybe in a couple of days. So we need initial conditions. So wherever you see time derivatives, we need their initial values. So we have a time derivative on the mass density. So we need initial mass density. This zero is for time. So we need initial mass density. We need initial velocity. And we will need, if it's a solid mechanics problem, we will need initial displacements. So wherever we have time derivatives, for every time derivative, we need an initial condition. So we have rate of change of mass density. So we need initial value of mass density. We have rate of change of velocity. We will need initial value of velocity. And if you substitute for velocity in terms of displacements, velocity equals rate of change of displacement of a material particle. So we will need initial displacements. In addition to these, wherever you see the spatial derivative, derivative with respect to space coordinate, we will need the boundary conditions. So the boundary conditions for this problem are the following. This is the potato shape we have, and we are in the present configuration. So the boundary of this potato, so that's the skin, you can say. So this boundary, we divide it into two parts, gamma u. This u is union. If you don't like the word union, then you can say plus. And this I'm going to put T for traction. So what I'm saying is the boundary has two parts. Either you can say gamma u plus gamma t, or you can say gamma u union gamma t, depending upon your preference. When technical, it is union, but if you don't like that word, you can say plus. Now this gamma u does not have to be, like, it does not have to be one part. It can be this, whatever I'm covering red, can be some of these three parts, can be gamma u. Like, in a plate, if my body is of a plate-like, so I can have edges clamped. So this is, I can have two edges clamped. So that means displacement is prescribed there. If I have all four edges clamped, then I have displacement prescribed on this surface. However, on the top surface, we generally give loads, forces, pressure. So we can divide the body, the boundary of the body, into two parts, gamma u, where displacements are given, and gamma t, where tractions are given. Now, tractions are present forces per unit present area. Now, in solid mechanics, that can pose a problem. So we will try to solve that in a little while. So at this time, we are working in the present configuration, which is not known to us. But in fluid mechanics, we work in the present configuration. So we know, so basically you draw either a free body diagram or a control volume, and the control volume is the shape of the body then. In solid mechanics, we don't draw any control volumes. But in fluid mechanics, we generally draw a control volume, and then the control volume becomes the present shape of the body. Okay, so on gamma u, u is prescribed. We use the word prescribed or assigned. Are given. All three mean the same thing. Displacement is given. R is prescribed. R is assigned. So if the displacement is prescribed as a function of x and t, then you can find the velocity also. So you cannot prescribe both displacement and velocity. You can prescribe one of the two. So if you are working in fluid mechanics, you will prescribe velocity. If you are working in solid mechanics, you will prescribe displacement. But not both. So what is it if this edge is clamped? So if this edge is clamped of the plate, so what is the displacement given here? So what is the given displacement on this edge then, if it is clamped?
Zero.
So physically, it's not easy to accomplish that. But that's what we assume. We, in mathematics, then we will write u equal to zero. Now, how can we make u equal to zero there? In, if you are doing an experiment, how will you do it? Yes? I think Josh should know it because he's doing these experiments or these kind of experiments.
That's what you're doing.
So how will you make it zero there? How will you prescribe it to be zero?
Clamp.
So basically you are assuming that your the device or the body to which it, you clamp this is rigid.
Or it weighs enough, large enough mass that like it's on an IV.
That doesn't basically deform much as compared to this one. But there is no rigid body, so it's an assumption.
Yeah.
And on the other part, gamma sub t, tractions are given. Traction is force per unit area. So what we are given is the Tij, that's the Cauchy stress tensor. N is the outward unit normal. This value, which we said is Fi, but we are going to put a bar on it. So if you apply loads here, those loads are given. So this is Fi bar. So you are wondering, but this might, what is this strange thing? So Tij is the Cauchy stress tensor. So that is, you evaluate that within the body. So let me give you a concrete example, say. Let's take a pressure vessel. So this is the cross section. And on this pressure vessel, let's say inner radius is A. And we have a pressure applied. So this pressure is PIN to indicate it's on the inner surface. So how will we write the boundary condition on the inner surface? So that's the question. How will we write the boundary condition on the inner surface. Does the problem statement make sense? We have a pressure vessel, say our artery, and there is a fluid inside the pressure vessel. No, I cannot say the blood is flowing through our artery because I'm going to say the fluid is at rest. Okay? So we have a gas tank, say, sitting outside in New Hampshire, wherever they have put oil in the gas tank under pressure. So the question is, how do we find the deformation or the expansion of that pressure vessel? So how do we write this boundary condition for this on the inner surface? Well, first of all, we know the equation of the inner surface is, so gamma t is x1 square over a square plus x2 square over a square equal to 1. Like it's x1 square plus x2 square equal to a square. So that's our part gamma t. Now what is n? What is the unit normal on the inner surface? So what is the inner normal on the unit surface? Remember, the normal has to point out of the body. So the body is this one. So the normal has to point out of the body. So what will be the components of this n? Let's say this point has coordinates x1, x2. Yes?
It's negative x1, x, negative x2 over the a, I guess, yeah.
So it's negative x1 over a, e1, negative x2 over a, e2. If you do not remember that, or you are having difficulty in figuring it out, write the equation of gamma t, which is like x1 square plus x2 square minus a square equal to 0. Take the gradient of this. So n equals the gradient of this. So if you differentiate with respect to x1, you get twice x1. And that's along e1 axis. Differentiate with respect to x2, you get twice x2. Along E2 axis, there is no differential with respect to X3, so that's zero. And now we have to normalize it because this is not a unit normal. So if you normalize it, you get 4X1 square plus 4X2 square. What I'm saying is that if you have a surface FXYZ equal to zero, the normal to this surface is gradient of F divided by gradient of f, its magnitude. But there's a plus minus sign here because when you take the square root, so this, that you have to figure out yourself. This math will not give you whether it's outward normal or inward normal. Like when I take the square root here, when I can say it is a plus or minus, that part, the gradient formula does not figure it out. All it tells you is along the normal. It doesn't tell you whether it's along the outward normal or inward normal. So in this case, it's minus, and because x1 square plus x2 square is equal to a square, so I will get 2a in the denominator, and that 2 and 2 will cancel. And we will get ni equal to, actually this is not quite, this is not written correctly. I should say n. Because on one side I had I as a free index, on the other side I did not have any I as a free index. So it was not written correctly. So it should be n equal to that. So what is then the boundary condition? The boundary condition is Tij, nj equal, now what is fi for this this situation. Pn is pressure, that is force per unit area. Pn is pressure, force per unit area. Along which direction is the pressure pointing? Remember, it's Fi, which is force per unit area. The magnitude of that force is Pn, Pin, like P subscript In. So what is the direction of that force? Is it along positive end or negative end?
Negative
end. Because if N is pointing this way, pressure is pointing that way. Again, I will ask you this in the exam, write the boundary condition. So you better know it. Actually, you know, there is, since all these lectures are taped, so if you run them, you can probably figure out what the exam will be. Okay, so if we, now let's write in components then. For I equal to 1, so we have T11, N1, plus T12, N2. There is no third component. So it's minus PN1, or T11, X1 over A is minus, plus T12, minus X2 over A, equal to minus P, X1 over A. And again, A cancels, minus sign cancels. And you are not happy. Speak up.
Because you have I in the right side.
I have I.
You cannot see I in the left where? Side.
I don't have I anymore here. I n is the, it's not I and n is, these are not indices. This is a pressure. P I n is the pressure on the inner surface.
I got it now.
This I n is not a index. This is pressure on the inner surface. If you like, I can write P1. But again, then you will say it's one component of P. So I don't know. This IN is not an index. So if you cancel minus, so we got T11 X1 plus T12 X2 equal to minus PIN X1. And then for I equal to 2, we will get T21 X1 plus T22 X2 equal to minus PIN X2. Of course, if I were working in the cylindrical coordinate system like R, theta, Z, then these will be written simply. And that's what you do when you studied pressure vessel in your mechanics of deforms class. When you studied pressure vessel in the deformed class, for a cylindrical pressure vessel, you use cylindrical coordinates. For a spherical pressure vessel, you use spherical coordinates, but you drew a free body diagram, and then you summed forces and moments. And we have already done that. So we already did that part when we took the, when we wrote the balance laws for a small p, like small part in the body, or shaded part in the body. So we are not drawing free body diagram anymore. So it depends whether you want to use the mechanics of deforms approach or you want to use continuum mechanics approach. So in the continuum mechanics approach, as I said, last time, these are kind of basic, well, these are not kind of, these are basic principles which every continuum must obey. No ifs or buts. You cannot say this body is of the shape of a my arm, or this body is my spinal cord, therefore it should not obey that. No. Everything, every continuous media must obey these three relations. We are not done yet because the way we have it, we have only one equation here. Because it's a scalar equation, so that's one here. We have three equations here, and we have three equations here. Because T12 equal to T21, T13 equal to T31, and T23 equal to T32. So we have 3 plus 3 plus 1, 7 equations. And we have unknowns. So we have 7 equations. And our unknowns are mass density rho, which we don't know. You know the mass density in the reference configuration. You know the initial mass density. You do not know the mass density after the body has been deformed. We do not know the velocity, or you can, it depends what you, whether you want to take displacement as unknown or velocity as unknown. So there is an R between not both. So there are 3 of those. And there are 9 of these. If you count these as equations, then you have to count these as 9 unknowns. So you cannot double count. Okay, so you count either these 3, these as equations, and if you do, then you count these as components. So you have 9 plus 3, 12 plus 1, 13 unknowns. So we need 6 more equations. We have 7 equations and 13 unknowns. Or if you say Tij is symmetric, then you will say you have 4 equations and 10 unknowns. We are short of 6 unknowns. We are short of 6 equations. We are short of 6 equations. Anyone has an idea from where we get those? What are those 6 equations? And I can guarantee you have come across those. You have certainly come across those. Whether you took fluid mechanics or solid mechanics, you have come across those. Yes, sir.
Is it related to the material? So, like,
yes,
the Hooke's law?
It is related to the material. Because we have not said anywhere so far what is the material of the body. So those 6 equations are related to the material of the body. But what is the technical name? What are they called? Yes?
Constitutive equations.
Constitutive equations. Can you give me an example of what you have come, where you have come across those? These are called constitutive equations. You have come across those, you have seen those, you have used those. No matter whether you took fluid mechanics or solid mechanics, you have used those constitutive equations. At least one of them, yes?
Like Hooke's law?
Like Hooke's law, yes. So Hooke's law says stresses are linearly related to strains. So those are 6 equations. Stresses are linearly related to strains. So those are 6 equations. And we will study those in a little while. Well, which little while means probably at least a week. Because we have not studied the problem for a solid mechanics yet. The difficulty is, the way we formulated this problem, omega is the present shape of the body. So what is the basic problem in continuum mechanics? And why are you here, and why am I here? I mean, you are here because ESM requires you to take the continuum mechanics class. So you don't have a choice. Those of you who are in mechanics department and doing master's or PhD, you don't have a choice. However, we have students from mechanical, like Josh. We have students from civil. Nestor is from civil. You are from civil. So why are you studying this course? Why are you taking this course? Because you want to learn how to find the deformed shape of the body. So the basic problem in continuum mechanics is, given the initial shape of the body and its material, and the initial conditions and the loads applied to it. Remember, you are given the initial shape of the body. You have to find the deformed shape. You have to find the final shape. So this omega is not known. That is the, if it were known, I will be out of a job. So the whole problem is finding that omega under a given set of loads and for different materials. So we can't really write our boundary conditions the way we did because we don't know gamma t and we don't know gamma u. So here we don't know gamma t. We do not know the final shape. When you do the experiment, how do you do an experiment? How do you do a simple tension test? All of you have, most of you have done a simple tension test. So how do you do it? Anyone will describe the procedure you use to do a simple tension test in an Instron machine or MTS machine? Come on, you took mechanics of deforms class, right? You did a simple tension test, you did a torsion test, you probably did a bending test. But how did you do the tension test? Pierce?
You just grip it at both ends and pull it with whatever instrumentation you need on there? I mean.
So you were given the initial specimen. So you skipped some steps. You are given this initial specimen, which according to the ASTM standard, American Standard of Testing Materials, has to be bone-shaped. If you are certifying that test, the specimen must be of the bone shape type. It has specific radii curvature at the ends. So you can't just take any, you cannot grab any piece, like Pierre said, and then test it. If you are going to certify it, and you better certify. And if you are in practice, you better do that. So you take this specimen. So this radius here is specified. This radius here is specified. The lengths are specified by the American Society of Testing Materials. And you are also given the width also is specified. Then you measure the width, you measure the thickness. But when are you measuring those? You are measuring those before you applied any load to it. That's in the reference configuration. Okay? And then you say, okay, I will put either a strain gauge on it or I will put an extensometer on it, depending upon how sophisticated you wish to be. And if you want to find both Poisson's ratio and Young's modulus, you will put a strain gauge in the lateral direction and you will put a strain gauge in the axial direction. Also, the MTS machine, as Pierre said, you grip it at the ends, but the purpose of gripping is to apply loads. Then you press the button and you keep on reading the load versus the strain. So what are you reading then? You are reading load P or F. This is the total force you are reading. You are not reading force per unit area. You are not reading force per unit area. Then either you use a lab view, like you use a software, you don't have to do anything, just press a key, or in my days, you find the stress by hand with a calculator. We did not have a calculator at that time. It was a slide rule. But anyway, you can divide by hand. So it's really no big deal. So you divide force by what? Which area you divide the force by? Now he's shaking his hand. His head now. So which area do you take to, yes?
It depends which strain you want to find. if it's
not which strain I want to find. No, strain has nothing to do with the area. If I divide force by area, what do I get?
Okay.
Stress. So, Jessica, what should I do? So if you take the reference one, so I will get present force over reference area. We did not talk about that. Our Tij, that Cauchy stress tensor we talked about, is present force per unit present area. And to find the present area, what do I have to do? I have to take a micrometer, measure the change in thickness, measure the current thickness and the current width, present width and present thickness. You cannot just press the button and go and for a cup of coffee and you come back and you are done. No. You have to stay there. You have to stop the machine and find, like with a micrometer, measure the current width and the current thickness. And then you will know the present area. And you divide the present force by the present area and you will get true stress or Cauchy stress. If you divide the present force by the undeformed area, as Jessica said, you do get stress. You get engineering stress, not false stress. The opposite of true is not false in our case. So we get, if you take present force over undeformed area, again, this is not written in correct English. So actually it's not written, there are two mistakes in it. One, mathematically it is wrong, and English-wise it is wrong. There is no such thing as undeformed area, and there is no such thing as force over area. So, because we don't know how to divide a vector by a vector, that's why writing force over area is not correct. So we are loosely writing this, okay? So undeformed area, I should really write surface area in the undeformed state, or undeformed configuration, or reference configuration. So this is called engineering stress. R is called nominal stress. So instead of saying true, we call it nominal. Or, no, you have been using the word Cauchy. So, but here there are two persons. One is Piola, that's the name of a person. And the other is Kirchhoff, and there are two H's in it, H as in Harry. There are two of them, not one. And there are two F's. So it's Piola-Kirchhoff stress tensor. Actually, it is first Piola-Kirchhoff stress tensor. And when I said first, there must be second. Otherwise, there is no point in saying first. See, we said right Cauchy-Green tensor because there is a left Cauchy-Green tensor. So there is no point in saying first Piola-Kirchhoff if there is no second Piola-Kirchhoff or third Piola-Kirchhoff. But there is only second Piola-Kirchhoff. So there is no third Piola-Kirchhoff. At least, I don't know it. But. Okay, now, so let's work in terms of the reference configuration. So we are going to go back again to our the small piece, P, in the present configuration, and look at it from where it came. Maybe we have been using P for points, so let's say it came from R. this chunk of material in the undeformed state has been deformed into this little chunk of material. Okay, so this is what F, the deformation gradient, did. And okay, so I will pick it up from here next time. That was, if I had not looked at the watch, I probably would have been here for another 15 minutes. Okay. If you did not pick up the homework problem, there are two homework assignments here.